Foreign policy and defense matters have traditionally been the preserve of the elites. There is a body of opinion which is very strong in many countries that you can't really allow people to take part in decision making and let them look into the way policies are made in many fields. But as far as defense and foreign policy are concerned, that must be the sanctum of some small group of people, those in the know, those responsible enough. Now, I think in the nuclear age, that tradition becomes too dangerous, because a very small mistake by the elite may result in a catastrophe that will end, if not only this particular country or a couple of others, but the whole world. So I think that the threat of nuclear holocaust, the threat of war, makes it imperative that public has the right to know of the major decisions that are being made, and that it has a say in formulating those decisions. Matters of war and peace are too important to be left to political leaders. The public must know and get involved.
Sergei Plekhanov is deputy director of the Institute for the Study of the USA and Canada of the USSR Academy of Sciences. He is one of the Soviet Union's principal experts on the United States. Today, Dr. Plekhanov shares some of his central insights into the reasons for perestroika and of new Soviet thinking on the quest for peace and security in the nuclear age.
Professor Plekhanov, a theme that's recurrent in your writings is perestroika is a challenge. What is the challenge as you think about it?
It is a challenge in many senses. To us in the Soviet Union, the challenge of perestroika is to change our society, our political system, our way of thinking in such a manner that will help us create a dynamic, free socialist society, which is, after all, what the revolution of 1917 was fought for. We've had a difficult history since 1917, and we have not really had a chance to realize the original intent of the revolution. The revolutionary process is a complex thing, and as a result of the Civil War, then the German invasion in the Second World War, as a result of Stalin's crimes and big mistakes that were made under his leadership, we sort of veered off course for several decades. And now we are renewing our society, and at the same time we are reclaiming the original promise. So that's a little bit like if you take the comparison with the history of Christianity, for instance. That's like Luther trying to revive the original idea of Christianity and challenging the Catholic Church. Well, now we have in the Soviet Union virtually two models of socialism. One that is dying. It's a bureaucratic and dogmatic socialism, which is simply not adequate to the needs of Soviet society. And second, the new socialism, which we're trying to build, socialism which is democratic and creative.
Let's focus on the characteristics of the second approach to socialism, a democratization is a term that is used recurrently in describing it. How do you use democratization? What is its meaning?
Democratization, democratization means making a society democratic, making a political system democratic. I think the basic meaning is the same as other nations put into this word, namely, putting power into the hands of the people, average citizens, giving them the peace of decision-making process, having all public affairs discussed openly, and having a system which is based on a sound legal basis, a government of laws and not men. Many other meanings. Democratization also involves making the economic mechanism accountable to the people, preventing the concentration of economic power in the hands of a few. That means democratizing the economy. Of course, it means guaranteeing basic rights and freedoms, such as freedom of speech, freedom of expression, freedom of conscience,
freedom of
association as well.
Is this kind of democratization possible in a one-party system?
I think it is possible. You see, one-party system, it depends on what kind of a party you have. We have a lot of views inside one party now. We have a pluralism of views. We have a lot of discussion within the party. And the important thing about democratization is that it is the party that is leading this democratization drive. It's coming from the top party leadership, and it's actively supported by rank-and-file members of the party. You see, the party itself, it's about 20 million people. 99% of them are common citizens who have no privileges whatsoever. They have additional duties as party members. They must be active citizens. They must get involved in public affairs. They must help the party leadership fulfill the goals, reach the goals which the party leadership sets. Only 1% of the party membership are the officials of the party, for whom being a party member is a profession. They are the secretaries, the district secretaries, the members of some members of Central Committee, officials on the staffs of various party organs and so on, but they're just 1%. So having the party being engaged in this democratization drive means having that army of citizens who are more advanced politically and who have that obligation to get involved in public affairs. So that's like the more active part of the community.
In describing Glasnost, this the first round of democratization, what are you trying to share?
Glasnost became the first round of democratization because Glasnost was the easiest part to do. It involved drastically curtailing censorship, reducing censorship, state censorship to a minimum. Just, you know, military secrets. So the rest of the work of the media, and Glasnost means freedom of the press in the first place. The rest of the work of the media is up to the editors and publishers themselves. So they are to judge what they will publish and what they will not publish. And they are actively encouraged to criticize what is wrong in the society, to expose various ills in society, to expose the public officials who are either corrupt or, you know, some have committed crimes and so on. And what's more, to be an active proponent of perestroika. But Glasnost also involves another thing. Glasnost involves an obligation on the part of public officials to conduct their affairs openly, to involve the public in decision making, So that's, glassness is an important element of democratization, but in terms of providing greater freedom for the press, that was the easiest thing to do, because all it involved was simply cutting off some of the bureaucracy's tentacles.
This gets to a second in issue described more difficult part of democratization, and that's economic democratization. What are the problems you're trying to solve?
Well, until Perestroika started, the official ideology was that under socialism, you primarily should have state ownership of the economy. The cooperative sector was not developed. The individual enterprise was not encouraged. Now, individual enterprise, cooperative enterprise, and state enterprise are all considered on a par. Integral parts of a socialist economy. There's nothing wrong with these various forms of ownership coexisting with each other, enriching each other. And within the state sector, where the biggest enterprises are concentrated, there is a democratization in terms of putting the decision-making power in the hands of the employees, of the people who work in the enterprises, starting with the election of managers. Managers are elected, and as well as shop managers, the top managers of enterprises, and so on. And reorganizing the process of work in such a manner that people who work in those enterprises feel that they are the masters, and it's their enterprises, giving them that feeling of being masters, and that's important for productivity, we think. That's important for bringing out the creative potential, which is in people, which is not being tapped nowhere nearly as adequately as much as it should.
What was it about what you described as micromanagement that kept this creativity from emerging?
Well, we have this terrible overregulation of the economic activity by the bureaucracy, the central ministries. I think we have something like 120 ministries in Moscow. It's just a disgrace. You can't run a complex modern society from the center. What you can do from the center is giving certain general impulses to the economy, and of course manage the financial system, certain basic parameters. But you can't really get involved in day-to-day management of enterprise. And we have now a system where, I mean the old system, which is dying now, which we're trying to revamp, where even the manager of a big truck plant on the Volga, the biggest in Europe, by the way, the biggest truck plant, the manager, has no right to replace the machinery in one of the shops in his plant without getting permission from Moscow. Now, I didn't know that. I learned that only when glasnost started. I think it's simply ridiculous, but that's where the over-centralization has led us. In fact, I think the reform, the economic reform, can be described by three words. Decentralization, de-bureaucratization, and democratization. These are the triad of the economic reform.
Third element for you, democratization, is in aiming toward an increased rule of law and not of regulation and central control. Mm-hmm. What does the rule of law mean in the Soviet Union?
Well, as I've said in the first place, it involves guaranteeing basic rights and freedoms of citizens. At the level of relations between organizations, between enterprises and the states, between various enterprises, between various levels of the state, all those social relations must be put on a sound legal basis, where they would certain legal obligations that parties will have to oblige by, because there is too much too much arbitrary decision making by the bureaucrats, and the law is honored more in the breach than in letter and spirit.
Why has that been? Your constitution is very clear in guaranteeing people access to law. Where didn't it work?
Because the constitution is, we wrote a new constitution in 1977, which was an improvement over the previous constitution that was written under Stalin in 1936. By the way, it was written by Nikolai Bukharin, one of our great leaders in the 1920s, and one year after he wrote that constitution, he was tried as a traitor and shot down, but the constitution was still there. But we wrote a new constitution in 1977. But it's not enough to write a constitution. There must be a sound body of laws which put that constitution into practice. And also there must be a respect for laws. We in Russia, we have a tradition which does not encourage respect for the law. We have a lot of proverbs and sayings which describe this attitude, traditional attitude of Russians toward law and legality, if you will. And of course, during the times of Stalin, this disrespect for law and the arbitrary arrests of people, the violations of human rights, they became part of everyday reality. And that, of course, bred cynicism of the law. So we're now trying to revive that respect for law and to create a sound legal system. On the other hand, we don't want to have this litigious society where everything must be decided in court. That would be something we don't want.
Okay. The American society is obviously a society that has some of the characteristics you're referring to that you don't want. How do you set up a structure that balances the rights of the individual and some system of due process in the face of what you've had historically as a strong government?
I think that even though our society is very complex, it's still the function of law is going to be simpler in the Soviet Union than it is in the United States. Because in the United States you have this inherent contradiction between great concentration of economic power within the hands of a few and the legal tradition, which is based on things like equality of citizens before the law and equal rights and fair treatment of various individuals. Now, how do you reconcile democratic principles with the facts of great concentration of economic power? In order to reconcile that, you need a lot of structures and practices and legal norms which would somehow help you grapple with that situation. Now, I don't think we're going to have that kind of a dilemma.
We see the genius of the American Constitution in part being its separation of powers, and where people, to get some checks and balances between the individual and society, that you can appeal to the courts, or you can work with the legislature, or you can advocate to the executive. That's our method of balancing the rights of the individual and the needs for us all collectively. How are you going to approach that problem?
Well, we'll see how it works. You know, we have a great social experiment now unfolding in the Soviet Union. We will create our own forms of democracy which are tailored to our needs and to the socialist nature of our society. We are studying very carefully the experience of other nations, including the United States. Now, one thing which can be said, one of the things that can be said in favor of your system is that system of separation of powers between executive, legislative, and judiciary branches. We would like, for instance, to give our Supreme Court in the Soviet Union the function of constitutional oversight of the executive, so that the Supreme Court would be able to pass judgment on the constitutionality and legality of government policy. There's a strong support in our country for that proposition, for such reform. And of course, the rights and the authority of the legislative bodies of our government are going to be increased. Again, that would provide a better balance between the executive, legislative, and judiciary branches of government.
In your lectures, you quoted Winston Churchill as saying that democracy is the worst form of government ever invented, except for all the others. How do you apply that to your own society at this time?
Well, you see, that's the phrase which I use in debates with my own countrymen who are somewhat apprehensive about democratization. Because to some of them, democratization entails a prospect of anarchy. There is a residual respect for tight central control of society. It seems that in order to have an orderly life in a complex and big society as ours, of 280 million people, of about 100 nationalities, on a territory which is the biggest, territorially, we're the biggest country in the world. And they say, well, you know, if we allow too much of self-expression, too much democracy, then we might have a problem. We might fall apart as a society. And to persuade such skeptics, you draw on various historical precedents and comparisons. But I happen to believe very strongly that a modern, complex society cannot be run other than by democratic means. There is something inherently wrong with the idea of running such a society on an overly centralized basis. You can have a tight central control of something which is much more simple and homogeneous. And when you have a diverse and big society, you have to introduce democracy if you want to have this system run on a sound basis.
What are the problems in a system that has some fear of anarchy, of introducing what you've called socialist pluralism?
The main problem is that people learn to use democracy. You know, learning to live in the conditions of democracy is not easy, as we're finding out. But it's something that that must be learned. And it's learning to live a better way, in a better way than we used to. So I'm optimistic that we will be able to develop those new ways of living in our society and running it.
What are the implications for the relationship of the Soviet Union and the United States to this process of perestroika?
I think perestroika is a very good thing for Soviet-American relations. Perestroika reduces the fears that Americans have of the Soviet Union, reduces the suspicion. When we become more open and we talk more openly about our own problems, I think that creates a better climate for our relations with the United States. And besides, you know, perestroika is contagious. It's a challenge not only to us, but to the whole world. When you have a big country, one of the biggest countries in the world, such as ours, undergoing such profound and dynamic change, that sets an example. I wouldn't be surprised if these processes of reform will start in other countries as well. In fact, in China, it started even before it started in the Soviet Union. And the logic of the process is in many ways similar to what's happening in our country. Then perestroika is important for Soviet-American relations because it involves also changes in Soviet foreign policy. We are much more strongly committed now to disarmament, to seeking mutually advantageous and cooperative relations with the West, not only the United States, but also Western Europe and Japan. It involves a cooperative approach to regional conflicts, and the conflict in Afghanistan, the settlement in Afghanistan, is one example of what we're talking about.
What forms of opposition to perestroika are there within the Soviet Union?
You know, the main barricades, if you will, are inside ourselves. I mean, each of us in the Soviet Union stands with one foot in the old age, in the old thinking, and with the other in the new thinking. So the dividing line is inside. But there are people who are more tied to old thinking than others. And of course, in politics, you always look to the interests involved that explain why this particular person takes this particular view on this or that issue. And of course, when you're talking about disempowering the bureaucracy, reducing the power that various groups of bureaucracy have in society, you're bound to have an opposition from those people because they're afraid of losing their privileges. They do not want to cede power voluntarily. But there's not much that they can do because perestroika is an imperative. We can't afford to fail in that effort. This is the only way for us. We've waited too long for it.
Is it irreversible?
I hope so. I hope so.
What is your vision for what your society will have accomplished when perestroika is fully in place?
Well, we will have a truly free society. We will have a very creative and dynamic society. We will have a sound economy. We will have a high standard of living. This is a society in which I would like my children to live, so I'm in a hurry.
Professor Plekhanov, thank you for sharing with us today your insights into the challenge of perestroika.
Revolution of 1917.